Imagine so great a mercy, what heart could fathom? Save the rest one. stars they wept, the morning sun was dead, the savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome. We're going to get started here in just a minute. If everyone could find a seat. A couple of things I wanted to say just as a matter of housekeeping before we begin. One is tomorrow at 6 o'clock at the Deer Valley High School, there's the last pitch celebration, and many of you know and followed Ross's baseball career, and there's going to be a celebration there. You can get more information in the foyer. And then after this the ceremony, there's going to be a balloon release ceremony outside with the family, and immediately following that, there'll be a reception in the cafeteria. So I'm very honored and also saddened to be here with you guys today. I'm honored because although I don't know Ross as well as many of you, I knew him well enough to call him a friend. And I knew him well enough to know that he was a good man. And he was loving, and he was honest, and he was sincere. He was a God-fearing, red-blooded American. He's the kind of man that the world needs more of, not less of. And that's one of the things that makes it so sad. The last time I wore this suit was at their wedding. And nobody should have to have a wedding and a funeral in the same year. And no parents should have to say goodbye to a son so young. And no wife should have to begin a family so soon after the passing. No friend should have to say goodbye to someone so early in their relationships. And yet here we are, saddened by this tragedy. And death is this weird thing because it's inevitable. And every single person in this room, we're all going to face it. We're all going to get there someday. But when it's experienced at such a young age, it's nothing less than a tragedy. And so we mourn together. And at the same time, we know that Ross was a man of faith. He loved the Lord. And Jesus said, in this world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. How can we be of good cheer in tribulation? He told us, because he has overcome the world. And even though many of you feel that you have been defeated and you have suffered a great loss, right now Ross isn't experiencing that. He has overcome the world in the name of Jesus. And I just want to encourage you, as we're about to enter into worship, and I'm going to invite the worship team to come on out. The last thing that you did with Ross, think about that thing that you did. The last conversation you had, the last moment you had with him, that is not the last thing that you're going to do with Ross. Because Ross is up in heaven right now worshiping the God that he loved, worshiping our Heavenly Father. And we're about to join him in that. And for everyone who's in here who believes in the name of Jesus, we're going to be doing that not just now and not just through the hardship and the difficult time of adjusting to a new life in his absence here on earth, but we're going to do that for all eternity when we're reunited with him and reunited with other loved ones in unity, answering the prayer that Jesus prayed in John 17 that we would all be one for all of eternity. And so I just want to invite us, all of us, to give praise to the God who has now overcome the world and with who Ross is having beautiful communion. And while, you know, Jesus said, I have told you these things, that you will have tribulation and you will overcome the world. He says, I have told you these things so that you might have peace. So let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the man that Ross was. And we thank you for the man that he continues to be in your presence. Lord, I pray that you would comfort those who mourn, that you would let us see a way forward, that there would be new life and an understanding of your eternal purpose, knowing, Lord, that in this world we'll have tribulation, we'll experience loss, things won't make sense, but we believe in Jesus' name that you have overcome the world, and now so has Ross, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen.
Would you join us?
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My way. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes. Yeah.
So good, with every breath I have all I need. Let this be our prayer today. On July 24th at 5:46 a.m., Kevin Ross Burbank took his last breath. But he left this world believing that the Phoenix Suns won the championship. He did. We were holding on. We were fighting hard in those last few days. We were looking for any bit of hope. All of Phoenix was. We had to give him something to live for. I personally believe he got the better end of the deal, living the ultimate Phoenix dream of winning the championship. So is that too soon to joke about that? How do you sum up the life of a 31-year-old? How do you sum up my brother's life? Two words come to mind when I think of Ross. And each of you in this room, if you knew him for any length of time, you will agree with me. He was a lover and a fighter. Two words don't describe him better than that. He was born on October 6th, 1989, with a roar of nurses and doctors who flooded the room due to complications, only to find out he's being extremely dramatic. There's nothing wrong with him, nor my mother. From the beginning, he had to fight hard with two older siblings, and boy, could he. He was loved very much from the start. He had to be in our family. And due to his size, rather large size. As kids, he was rough and tough, loving the typical shows like Power Rangers and not so typical shows like Walker Texas Ranger. And he was always trying his moves on us, which we hated. However, anyone who knew him and knew that if you hurt his feelings, he was nothing but mush and tender inside. He had a heart of gold. These two characteristics of loving and fighting would serve him all his life. All that knew him knew that whether our family, church family, as it shows in this room, school family, his friends, baseball boys, family friends, our global family, we all knew this lover of ours had a heart that was pure gold. His unique God-given gift of loyalty displayed his heart so, so well, often being more loyal to others than what others could be or to him in their own capacity. But that never, ever stopped him. This boy of ours also had convictions. If you knew him, he had strong convictions for the world around him and his belief in faith, as his wife sits there and chuckles. Fighting for justice and convictions for God that stemmed from that big heart of love of his. He loved his family and all those around him well. It was a gift of his. And man, those big, big hugs. Who could forget? As you see in the program that we've given out in the obituary, he had a lot of talents. He had a lot of successes and dreams. He lived a lot in his life, his short, short life. But none even come close to this girl that sits on this front row, this beautiful woman of his wife, Michaela. For years, people would ask me all around the world, from friends in New Zealand to here, what kind of a girl do you think this boy will settle down with? And, oh, sheesh, I literally go, your guess is as good as mine. But here's what I would say. All I know is that she will have to be pretty special. One, to survive this crazy family of ours. And two, she will have to have the right balance to handle his strong convictions, yet his extremely delicate heart. Here enters Michaela. Can you give me a tissue? That's your job. Oh, thanks. Taught him well. Okay. After our first meeting her, it was about 2 years ago, I knew she was it. She was the most level-headed. She was calm and yet seemed to have a roar in her heart that laid under the surface. She loved God, and boy, did she love Ross. Ross faithfully called us or talked to us through text at least once a week. He would call the kids or text John or myself. And it was one of these times, I'm pretty sure the words John and I used was, seal the deal, dude. Michaela, I know I've shared this with you. I have, but I think it should be known that my one piece of my brother going to heaven is knowing that he got to experience not just love, but that he was loved well. Anyone who knew him knew that he'd done a lot in his life. He had a lot of dreams. He had a lot of ambitions. He was extremely ambitious, but none came close to his desires to be a husband and a father. And while our hearts cry because it wasn't enough here in our eyes and our earthly perspective, I'm so thankful and lay at peace at night knowing that he got to experience love. Many people have grown into marriage, but these two from day one just fit together, and they adventured together. Something you will do with Juniper, no doubt. Ross also dreamed of being a daddy. Michaela, while we share this grief and knowing that she will not know him in those ways, we love you both, and we will make him known. I remember when John entered the family, and even my own kids, every trip back, and they meet cousins and family. And I remember Miley at 3 years old coming up to me. She goes, another cousin? We have a lot of family, extended family. I remember John saying, like, so which cousin is this? I don't know. It's a cousin. Like, we don't have titles in this family. But I want to say this. Once you're in this family, Michaela, you're forever in this family. Sorry. But we're committed to you. We're committed to that baby of ours, of yours. You're stuck with us. This Ross of ours loved, and he fought right to the very end. Guys, very hard in ways that we're not even able to share at this time. He fought hard. I struggle in my heart, as so many of you pointed out kindly, that I'm so glad has brought you guys back here for this time. Months ago, I knew we needed to get home to Phoenix. It almost became a physical reaction that I needed to be with our family. I don't understand it all, and I thank God, along with you all here, that we are here. But in my heart, I struggle because this is what it was not supposed to be. We had so many plans together as a family, this front row and us. And Ross, boy, he was leading the charge with that. But here's what I know, is I trust my God. He will give us a peace beyond understanding. He will do what only he can do and give us peace on the days that it's hard, on the days where we're righteously angry, on the days we can continue to fight for others to not experience what our family has experienced. And I say that with integrity and honesty and righteousness before you. Mom and Michaela, Mom, I want to honor you. Mom, you've carried what no mother should carry. But even leading up to his passing, you carried what no mother should carry. And I honor you. As we as a family, I know Jeff and Megan share this with us, is that we are so proud of you. And I know that my God will allow you to carry what we have gone through as a family, and you will use that and channel it, and God is gonna use it and has marked your life, because this is what any mother in this room knows, is don't mess with Mama Bear. But you also love God, and you wanna do the right thing, and I honor you, Mom. Michaela, I honor you. This girl, through the whole time, remained calm, steadfast, level-headed. But boy, did she fight hard. Both her and Mom were an amazing, beautiful team, and I honor you both before everyone here. And let it be known how calm and steadfast you both were and loving to partner with that hospital right to the very end, and I honor you for that. So today, as we say goodbye to my brother, we've also already said goodbye as a family. But I'm so overwhelmed with the amount of people that are here this morning. to say goodbye, and you represent so much of his life. And at the end, we have a slideshow, the very end after the family shares. And we stuck to just family because, to be honest, that kid had friends. He had a lot of seasons in his life, and he was such a loyal friend. And he wasn't just a friend that just popped in and out with people. He did life with people. He would go back and visit his teachers years later, his elementary school teachers, his junior high, high school. He would go and actually journey with people and stay in touch, whether it was globally, out of state. He journeyed and pastored and loved people well. And for that, my brother, I honor you. Thank you for being so loyal to us. Thank you, God, for having our family in your hands.
Thank you, Alyssa. I'd like to invite Michaela's family to come up and speak, please.
My name is Chelsea. I am Michaela's oldest sister. I'm kind of reading this on behalf of our whole family. Whew. Ross was our brother and son-in-law and cherished uncle to our children. Everyone knows you can't pick your in-laws, but we're so lucky that Ross chose us. Although he was only in our lives for 3 years, it had felt like we have known him forever. He was always down for our crazy shenanigans, whether that be making coyote noises in the kitchen, ping pong ball fights, fishbowl games, random walks in crazy heat, because the kids always wanted to go out, hide and go seek with his nieces and nephews, building projects that made the contractor in him frown, and keeping our group chat exciting, and sometimes being the chosen uncle over Madeline's own dad. But the reason we were most blessed by Ross is because he chose to love our Michaela. There was no doubt that he loved her. He planned the most beautiful and special proposal. He would affectionately rub her back or hold her hand. He planned amazing trips that allowed them to create the best memories together. He wanted their first look at the wedding to be just them because he knew he would get emotional seeing his most beautiful bride the first time. And his wedding vows brought us all to tears. He always shared pictures of the two of them on their adventures, bringing us along for the ride. Whenever Ross was around, there was a calmness. The last memory I have is sitting on the couch with the two of them, his arm around Michaela, rubbing her baby bump, and there was a unique peace. Michaela and Juniper were his home, his safe place. 1 Timothy 6:11 through 12 comes to mind when we think of Ross. It says, "But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight. Take hold of the eternal life in which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses." Ross exemplified these things. He pursued righteousness, godliness, and faith as he led his family in devotions and prayer. He pursued love by demonstrating how Christ loved the church as he loved Michaela. He was unwavering in who he was and what he believed. He was a true gentle giant. All our kids adored him. He fought the good fight spiritually and always stood up for what he believed in. Ross's legacy will be carried on when little Juniper loves chocolate milk, when she raises her eyebrows like he did, when she laughs a deep belly laugh, and Ross's love will reach Michaela with every "I love you, Mommy." We miss you greatly, Ross. Words cannot express the massive void we feel with you gone. But we will take care of your Michaela and Juniper until they can be in your arms again.
Thank you, guys. I'd like to now invite Mom and Dad. And as they're coming, I just pray, Lord, Put your spirit in this room. Fill us with grace and eloquence, and let us articulate how awesome Ross is. In Jesus' name.
As I sat down to write a few thoughts about my son, I thought, how can a mom best describe her son in just a few short minutes? There are so many things that come to mind, as any mom would agree. He was my baby. And even at 31 years old, he seemed quite proud of it. He was spoiled, but whenever anyone would say that, his immediate response was, "No, I am just well cared for." He had a great sense of humor and could always make us laugh. If he upset you, it would undo him until he made it right. He loved people, and it showed in his everyday relationships. He loved kids, and during my 30 years of in-home daycare, he became the favorite with many of them. He adored and looked up to his older brother and sister. Jeffrey, you had the patience of a saint with Ross. Especially when you were younger, the way he followed you around. I love seeing your connection as you became adults. And he had a wonderful relationship with Alyssa, even when she was half a world away. I know he was always calling and texting. There was always a connection of love. He adored his nieces and nephews. And had an incredible relationship with each one. They all loved their Uncle Rossi, and his absence is tremendously felt. When Ross was born, I was able to stay home full time, and I had this crazy thought that I would make up in him what I thought I had lost in Jeffrey and Alyssa when I was working outside the home in their younger years. Well, didn't work out so well because I created a monster. I couldn't go into the bathroom without fingers under the door and a meltdown. I couldn't go to the grocery store and leave him at home with his dad and siblings without major tears. Even going to Sunday school was an ordeal. Later, his teachers asked if Daddy could bring him because he didn't cry when Daddy dropped him off. But with Mom, it was a different story. He had me around his little finger and still did at 31 years old. He was all perpetual motion. He never sat still and was always on the move. I remember thinking at one time that he had ADD. And I remember being told, "No, Mom, you just have a very active little boy." We were constantly pulling him out of the dryer or off of oleander stalks, down from ladders, and then a couple of trips to the ER with stitches. There was never a dull moment, as he thought he could do anything his older brother and sister could do, and most times he could. I remember when he learned to ride his bike. He was 3 years old, and he got on it in the morning and was racing with the other boys in the afternoon with such ease and confidence. It surprised us all. He was the kind of kid that at 3 years old would sit on the couch with his ball glove in his hand and watch The Sandlot every single day. To the point where we wore out two of the VHS tapes.
Remember those?
He would laugh before the funny parts because he knew what was coming. Then around 6 years old, he developed a love for Walker, Texas Ranger. He had a little denim vest with a little sticker badge and play handcuffs and a little notepad. And after he would watch an episode, he would go into the backyard and we'd see him running around recreating whatever episode he had seen. And he would try out some of these moves on his sister, which never ended well, as you can imagine. So this is where his love of law enforcement started. But baseball was his passion. He grew up watching Dad play on church and city leagues, and his big brother play Little League. His first season of T-ball was quite interesting because if we would have gauged it off of that, he would have never played again. All he wanted to do was hit the ball. He didn't want to take turns or play in the outfield. There was a time when he would get mad and he'd cross his arms as the ball would roll right by him because he didn't want to catch it. He wanted to be the one hitting it. So, however, the next year was a whole different situation, and the rest is history. It became his passion, and he excelled at it. We tried to get him into other sports, but baseball was his life. His team of guys became family as we spent many hours at the field, at tournaments, and traveling together. His love of baseball enabled him to play for some amazing teams, be part of a 5A high school state championship, and essentially earning 3 full offer scholarships to college. But his love of family was very strong. Even as a little kid, we knew he wanted to be married and have a family. And when he met Michaela, we instantly knew he had found the girl. We all loved her. I remember Alyssa telling him that if he messed this up, we were going to get rid of him and keep her. As a parent, seeing their love for each other was so beautiful. We saw how she loved and adored him. What more could a mom ask for? And he loved Big 2. Every phone call ended with, "I love you." And whenever he would go to leave, he would always give us a hug, a kiss, and say, "I love you." I remember people commenting on this, but to us and our family, it's as normal as breathing. When he told us they were expecting, what a joyous occasion. Seeing Ross get excited over onesies, diaper bags, and car seats was such fun from this 6'4" guy of ours. We are so incredibly thankful that he was there to witness the birth of his beautiful baby girl. He got to hold her and love on her, even though it was for a short time. We will make sure that Juniper knows how much she was loved and wanted by her daddy. She will hear all the stories. I didn't want this time to be of great sadness, even though it is something we cannot get away from. A life taken way too soon. I want people to know this son of ours lived life big with a heart to match. I want people to know he loved his family and cherished all his friendships. I want people to know he had the best sense of humor and a love for country, guns, and God. I want people to know he loved his wife and beautiful baby girl and would have been the best daddy ever. I want people to know he loved God and is now with him. These last 2 weeks have been the most painful thing our family has ever been through. A parent is not designed to bury a child. I have never experienced a loss so tremendous. It is hard to describe, but in the midst of the most unbelievable despair, God was there. When Michaela and I were allowed to go see him, and our family was gathered at the curbside outside the hospital in utter despair, God did what only God can do and brought us peace. It was a peace that has carried us through the unimaginable. It is a peace that came from the multitude of family, friends, and even strangers from around the world praying and lifting our family's arms when we were too weary. We felt them all. It is a peace that we will cling to as we now are on this journey of healing. Ross will always be a part of us. And now, as we move forward, I know there will be days or moments that will knock us to our knees. But I also know the God we love, the God our son loved, is still in control. In our weakness, he is made strong. We don't understand the whys, and we may never, but God. Tucked in the pages of my Bible, I have special things from all my kids. During my devotions this week, I came across this piece of paper that was written by Ross in 2014, and I'd like to read just a little bit of it to you in his own writing. It says, Shout out loud, Jesus wants to hear your voice. He knows your desires and loves your story. You don't need anything to make your life a legacy. You are that legacy the day God said you would be born. I have strength and power. Satan has no hold on me. I have one thing in my side, and that is, I have one thing on my side that he does not, and that is Jesus. No one is stronger or more powerful than him. 2 Corinthians 4:16, 18 says, we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So in conclusion, my physical time with him may be over. As difficult as it is, I am reminded that when we dedicated his life to God as a baby, knowing that God was his, God now holds him in his hands. I am grateful, blessed, and honored that God chose me to be Ross's mom. There's a book that became very special to Ross and I. And we would read it to him. I would read it to him as a little boy. Even to adulthood, every card and some conversations texting back and forth would end with, I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. I love you, Ross. We will take care of Michaela and Juniper until we can see you again.
Wow, 31 years is represented here. Imagine if he'd had 60 in the relationships that he built. I need that out on the table. I don't see it down there anywhere. Thank you all for your prayers and support. I'll get through this. At this time, the bullpen, which I represent, or that represents as the family, I'm referring to the family as the bullpen, we're called upon to share the stories of 31 years and our memories of Kevin Ross. If you know him, he used storylines, titles, quotes, comic relief, and to express himself or lighten the moment. There was never a dull moment around the Burbank table. You have a task to do right now. Participate here. I have 4 references to movies, and you're to pick the one that he would pick as this time we've been sharing. The first one is Fast and the Furious. The second one's Back to the Future. The third one is Groundhog Day. The fourth one is Here's Your Sign. He always lightened it and always had a comment. One of Ross's favorite comedians was Bill Engel. You can already laugh, you can hear it, you've been around him, you've heard him. But one of the episodes is Too Much Information. That was like, as a younger, that was one we always heard around the table and different things. Look it up, Google it, and think about him as you're listening to it. We can all, in conversations, we all wonder, what is our first encounter with God when we get to heaven? And I truly believe in my heart that his first encounter was because of his heart, his tenderness that you've heard referenced. He looked at God square in the eye and said, did I do something wrong? Did I do something wrong, Father? 31 years. And God's immediate reaction, I could hear it. Let me get myself focused back here. Thank you. He'd say, no, my son, you were a good and faithful son. With relief then and a smile, Ross turned to St. Peter and said, hey, dude, where'd you get those jandals? I want a pair. That would be lighten the load, lighten the moment. Ross was a great team player in life. Anybody that worked with him, played with him on the field, however, it didn't start out that well. I used to travel on the road in construction. I'd be gone for 4 to 6 weeks at a time, and so the kids would take turns sleeping with mom. Start with the oldest, go to the youngest. If I came home in the rotation and it was night, he lost it because it was his turn. And so he appealed to the mother of, or mama court, the mama court, and pleaded his case. Oh, daddy can go sleep in my bed, and it's my turn to sleep with you. Well, the Supreme Court of Dad, of course, overruled that. And we worked through it. And but every time I'd come home, we'd go through that same thing. The morning that Ross went to be with our Heavenly Father, I was reminded of Psalms 23. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And it just came to be a peace, that just gave me a peace that morning. It was just unbelievable. One of my ongoing statements, if you work around me, work with me, work in the field, my statement for a long time has been, just get her done. Just get her done. And I've lately been reminding people of changing that thought to don't take. Hang on a second here. Let me get focused again here. Don't take tomorrow for granted. About 6 months ago, I started to have that real in my spirit to start sharing that. Just don't take tomorrow for granted, not knowing what we were getting ready to face. But it was preparing me, but it was also preparing my heart to share with others. As Leanne mentioned, and I mentioned too, about how it would undo Ross if he knew something was upset him, or you upset with him, he wanted to make it right. So my new challenge for all in this day forward, let's learn from Ross. It is not about being right or wrong, but being able to speak into a relationship to build a stronger community. Do not let yesterday's indifferences define the outcome. This might get a little emotional. Ross got me a Father's Day present this year and didn't get a chance to complete it because they were looking for pieces to put together. And I don't know, somewhere in the days following of his death and whatnot, Leanne had found it and took it to Michaela, and Michaela presented it to me. But it says, "Dear Dad," it's got a picture of a dad. It's got a picture of me and Ross on my shoulders, if you can believe that. "Dear Dad, thank you for teaching me to play, for getting me to my games, for being my superhero, for believing in me, for being my biggest fan." And when I saw this, I have to do a little explaining. Is that until he got to high school, his number was 21. And when he got to high school, he started questioning me on, "Hey, Dad, when you played Little League, when you played all this, I don't remember, what was your number?" And I was like, "Well, my number was 14. So I didn't know at the time why he was asking me. Well, I found out later that that was the number he picked when he got to high school. Well, the reason was because the coach, Eubanks, was 21. So I was looking at this the other day, and I'm like, one of us has got a problem because he beat us to the big team. He either picked 21 or 14. I'm not sure which of the one it was, but Larry, we got a problem. So, it was very, 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 very touching when I got that. And Michaela, of course, and I had our moment. It wouldn't, in conclusion, okay, a family get-together wouldn't have been a family get-together if they had not identified jokes that I had spoke that were considered dad jokes. So, I have three. It took me a while to find some that I had not seen before. Want to hear a joke about paper? Never mind, it's terrible. Number two is, I could tell you a joke about pizza, but it's a little cheesy. Then number three, to conclude, which I thought when I found this, this would be the ending, was, when does a joke become a dad joke? When it becomes apparent. Thank you, my son, for allowing me to be your dad. You will never be forgotten. Until we meet again, we will take care of your precious little family. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. I'm going to go ahead and ask Michaela to come on up.
It's too bright up here. first of all, good morning. Second, I want to invite everyone to just kind of look behind you, look to your side. Ross was a people guy. He loved family. He wanted everyone to know everyone, including y'all over here, knowing everyone here. Because you guys became family. And so I want to have dinner with everyone. I want to get to know you all, even if I don't know you now. So with that, Alyssa kind of stole my words. But we picked words, and it identifies people. So there was a few things that I was able to see him as. He's many things. He's a loving husband, kind, faithful, gracious. He's an awesome daddy to Hobbs. for a whole year, we got to just invest our time together. He was so gracious with him, even though he would yell at him and hit him and whatever, not hit him, but like, more so just kindly grudge him and push him to where he needs to be. Let's say that. He loved that guy so much. And I got to correlate it with how he would be a juniper. Which is so cool to see. When you think about everything that led up to the last few weeks, he knew what was going on. Even to our finances being in my name. Everything up until this point makes sense. And somehow Ross and God had the perfect plan in putting things together. So, he was loyal. He stayed true to family. He stayed true to people in this room. He would share stories about who and how everyone connected. 'Cause y'all connected. Going off script, I'm not very good with notes. So, we can keep going here. Kind of like dad, we get lost, it's okay. he's a man adventure. He always wanted me to know what we were doing the weekend coming up. or the next day. He's like, okay, what are we doing next? Because he wanted it to be special. He always planned what we were doing, even though I'm a terrible planner. A guy being a planner was great for me because I didn't plan at all. Even to our last trip to Vegas, he was like, he never told me what we were doing, but he always had a plan. He knew what was going on, even though no one else did. We had plans. We had so many plans. We had plans of going to every stadium in America, no matter if it was a little league team ball field or the major leagues. We had to go see them all. And he would drive back and tell me where he played. So I will continue to show Juniper every baseball field that I see. to go in to see all of the major league teams and touring them all. We got to tour the Rocky Stadium in Denver when I was living there. And he was like, oh, this is where that was. And he knew all the little details before the guy even shared about the tour. We'll go to New Zealand and he'll show me, or y'all will show me where he went, and Turkish, and I'll try to love it, even though it's not my favorite. It's okay. It must be better there, I hope. Okay, good. he was determined to show me the world. He's a man of justice. Probably a big topic word for him. I remember one time we were almost an hour late to family dinner because we had to follow this one car that there was a drunk driver, and he had a Mickey's can in the console that Ross had seen. I didn't see it. You remember this? We're an hour late because we had to follow him down I-17 the wrong direction until the police pulled him over. And eventually, 30 minutes later, he did. But he wouldn't let anything go until he felt right about it. To Mother's Day this year, we were getting cards and whatnot for everyone before breakfast, and this mom left her kid in the car, and he got so riled up about it. She left the kid, and then we all went in, and he had to go find the mom and tell her that's not okay. and he did. He found her. And she went and got her kid and brought him into the store. but he wouldn't let anything go before he could tell and make sure people were okay. And it led to his career. Thank you all for being here, officers. We appreciate you. I saw you over there. He has so many stories of how he was able to help inmates and just different connections he was able to make. So if y'all could share with y'all, thank you so much. And Bayo, thank you for giving us our little kid Hobbs. He cherished your friendship so much. So, I mean, I could go on, and there's so many people in this room that there's memories and stories, and my goodness. And I want to hear all about them. And that leads to, he was fun. He was a fun guy. He would come home and have to tell me something that would make me laugh or smile. That was his determination. And everyone around him. Like you were saying, he shared life through movies and stories, and his smile probably was the most contagious. He was loved and loved well. Um,
He loved every niece and nephew. He loved every intricacy of each and every part of who y'all are. Up from the first one to the last one. I remember when my sister, my older sister, named all of her kids. They have fun names. And he was like, okay, how do you spell them all and how do you get their names right? Because the Kila, Caius, and Callan. He was like, I gotta get them all right. He wanted to make sure he had it right. And for the first few months, he struggled, but it's okay. loved. He was my first and only. He valued every relationship he ever had. We had 15 pages of just me writing about us two, and I figured I wouldn't read all 15 pages to y'all. but he loved well, and he loved in every piece of being he was. He was kind-hearted, loyal, trustworthy, patient, and saw me well. Ross's legacy will be lived on by the stories we all tell, his memories, by the way he will be remembered. We will continue to fight for justice for those who need it, as Ross would have. I promise to raise Juniper in a way that he'll be proud of. I'll teach her how to love pickles, even though I hate them. Papa will teach her, because I hate them, like, as a passion. Y'all also have to teach her how to love ketchup and chocolate milk. I can do that, but... and we have to teach her how to drink a whole gallon of milk in a week. Because he was really good at that. We also have to teach him how to love America, because that was his pride and joy. And maybe have to keep collecting them or something, because we got at least 10 right now. So most of all, I think just being able to share Juniper so much with everyone here, and just meeting with her and loving her well. I think that's how she'll feel him the most. So, in closing, thank you so much for being here, everyone. It means the world to him. And as we meet in the next few weeks, months, years, let's not stop talking about him. Because that's how things get harder, when we just start forgetting. So, thank you. I'll pass it off.
Thank you, Michaela. I'd like to ask our gracious host, Pastor Mike Maiden, to come up now.
We're going to pray for... thank you, family. I've had the honor of being in many, many memorial services. I can't ever remember a family speaking this beautiful, this eloquent, and this heartfelt. So thank all of you that spoke for the family. It was really touching and significant. We have a promise from God. In 2 Corinthians, the Bible says, the God, our Father, who's the God of all comfort. And the promise is that he will comfort us in any and all trouble, pain, anguish in this world. And that comfort stays with us for the entirety of our life and becomes a ministry to help other people going through similar things. 25 years ago, the Lord healed me from a serious clinical manic suicidal depression. And I know Jesus can heal hearts. I know he can. He healed my broken heart. And we're going to ask, I'm going to ask you if you would, if you're comfortable with this, just stretch your hands toward the family sitting here in the front row. And we want to just express as believers our love. By the way, thank you for coming today. They feel loved. They feel your love in that. And we're going to pray for them and just express our love. And over the next few weeks, as you think of the family, just say a prayer for them. Because God's grace will flood their lives, flood their souls, and sustain them. The Bible says hundreds of times, don't fear. Don't fear, don't fear. The Bible never says one time, don't grieve. So grief is God's way of helping us through loss, and this is a loss. But God's grace and his love and his comfort will always be there for you, Mom and Dad and Michaela and brother and sister and all family and friends. Just help me pray. Father, we lift up this beautiful family. We are touched hearing their words of honor and celebration for their son and their brother, their husband. And Father, we know you will watch over this family. And today, Lord, we ask that they would feel such a outpouring of your grace, your strength, your comfort, your love, your care. Just like it was said earlier, when Moses was weary, someone held his hands up, Lord. I thank you for holding the hands of this family up, their hearts up. I pray in those moments when just waves of grief comes, God, that you would in those moments meet them also with waves of comfort, waves of peace, and waves of your care and your love. We thank you for the baby daughter, Lord, and we pray for her that you would do such extraordinary, supernaturally favorable things in her life, that even though her natural father has gone home too early, that she would see, God, time and time again, your hand in her story. And we thank you, God, for your faithfulness. Thank you, God, for your care. Thank you, God, for this life that we've celebrated today, honored. In Jesus' name, amen.
I spent a couple decades with the Burbanks, Ross, annoying at first, fun later. I was thinking early this morning whenever I woke up, he's over there enticing Babe Ruth, like, hey, let me pitch to you. I bet he could strike him out. Because I was thinking back in the day of Babe Ruth, like, they were only pitching in the high 80s, you know, 90s. Like, I bet Ross is smoking it past him. And that belly laugh. Funny. I want to lift up the Burbanks, and I want to say that there is absolutely something tangibly seen different in this household, in this family. And I know it's because of the love of Christ. I know that it's the basis in which Ross lived. Kevin isn't the guy I know. Ross is the guy I know, so Kevin's there. Ross, I'll refer to him now. Amazing how Ross is where I want to be. I've lived my life to get where Ross is. Now it's us who pick up the pieces. It's us who learn to grieve. It's us who deal with this and deal with this well. Ross was a bit of a warrior, mountain of a man, but a warrior. And a verse that we had talked about a lot was Philippians 1:21. To live is Christ, to die is gain. What the heck does it mean to die is gain? Like, what is that? To live is Christ, okay, I can understand that. We fumble through, we try to understand that the substance of life, the substance of existence is Jesus Christ. We sang songs about that. We understand that root. And then you go to 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13. It says, brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death,
so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. When it comes to endgame, Ross is there. Ross is at the pinnacle. He's in the presence and glory of Jesus. The same presence transformed Moses' physical appearance by seeing just a glimmer of the shadow of, and Ross is basking in the full glory. Well done, bro. Like he cheated us, right? But he had a full life. He received everything that his heart desired. Many of you guys, friends, relationships, love. Love filled him to the brim. He got a wife. He got a baby. He got everything, and God said, hey, bro, well done, come home. And he's there where I'm fighting to be. The story's not over. The story's contained in us and all of our stories and all of our memories, and which you guys need to go out into the foyer and write them down. They've got an awesome memory there where you can write down whatever comes to mind. Share your experiences with Ross. Dude's bigger than life. He's affected us all. Share those stories so that Juniper can grow up and read about the man that he was, about the friend who he is, and about the Christian life he led. We had opportunities of counseling Ross through relationship, praying that this one didn't work, and then Michaela comes on scene praying that that one did. We were with John and Alyssa on that. We're like, oh, Lord, please don't let him screw this up. And he didn't. I find myself in a position of celebrating because Ross has won. I'll be here in the meantime thinking about memories, thinking about the absence of Ross, being here with a family with a heart that's really, truly ripped apart. And that's all right. We can deal with us. We can be here for one another. We can be here in the needs that we have and the relationships that we desire. So with that, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for being the gracious Father to take Ross and put him by your side, Lord. I thank you for envisioning his life as being complete and full so that he can go and be with you for eternity. Lord, I thank you for his presence. I thank you for the mountain of a man that you created so that he can come into this world and shape it and change us because we knew him. Lord, we entrust him into your hands. We thank you for the gift that he is. And it's with great happiness that we leave him in your glory. We say these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Awesome. I want to thank absolutely the people in New Zealand who are watching this, who have been a part of this journey. Ross is loved around the world. Kind of funny, right? But I also want to talk about the keepsakes. Go out there and just put your heart on a piece of paper. Why are you here? Let the family know. Let Juniper know. And then in true format, as Ross would appreciate, there's a country song that says, let's have a party. That's the best I get. We are going to have a party. We're going to have a celebration of life. For Ross, he's won. For us, we're going to learn to have joy in that. So there will be lunch in the cafeteria. Hopefully a few of you guys brought food and you know where that is, because I don't know where it is, but I'm following you. And really, truly, just embrace the atmosphere in which he created. The friendships, the relationships. I want to attest on the family's behalf and say that, man, I have seen them go to next level. I've seen Pastor Kevin come out of the woodwork and just drop it like it's hot. It was like, whoa. Leanne, through tears, ministering to me like I was just in awe on the heart of this woman. Jeff and Alyssa, Michaela, even Juniper. I'm intrigued by the story of Ross Burbank. I'm intrigued of the glory of setting him free. Michaela and Juniper have a GoFundMe account. I encourage you guys, what's that QR code? I'm a little bit older. You can take a picture of the QR code if you have it on your device, and it'll send you to the link, and you guys can pledge. Ross was the provider for the family. That's a real physical, tangible need that we can step into and help out. There will be many needs in the course of years to come. I just hope that we're there. Pray that Ross's legacy lives on. We have about 12-minute clip. And in that time, we'll take Ross out and prepare his body for rest. So with that, please do sentimental notes in the foyer, GoFundMe, and stick around for the party for lunch. All right, watch this, please.
Crash and 100 other dopey names. Forget about that stuff, kid. We ain't got much time. Let me tell you something, kid. Everybody gets one chance to do something great. Most people never take the chance, either because they're too scared or they don't recognize it when it spits on their shoes. This is your big chance, and you shouldn't let it go by. I mean, you remember when you busted the guts out of the ball the other day? Someone's telling you something, kid. If I was you, I'd listen.
Yeah. But what?
You're the one with the rubber legs. Figure it out. Remember, kid, there's heroes and there's legends.
Heroes get remembered, but legends never die. Follow your heart, kid. You never go wrong.
I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky. The first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, where I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will share the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm darkness in this world we stumble through, all these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Thank you.
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children.
From the moment that I wake up, till I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. In the goodness of God.